Live, local, now. This is the News at 11.
And good evening. Thanks for joining us, everyone. Our First Alert meteorologists have been tracking severe weather all day long today.
And tonight, we're continuing our team coverage with John Wetherbee, Jamie Ertle, and WTOC reporters Tesia Reed and Stephen Gallo are live at Fort Stewart right now. We'll be getting to them in just a few minutes as they are surveying the damage and talking to homeowners.
But first, Jamie Ertle is joining us now with the latest on this storm. Jamie?
Right now, Russ and Dawn, I wanted to show you the First Alert advisories and warnings. We have nothing across the coastal empire and low country, and we have no watches or warnings, so that is great news. So let's put this into motion. We've been using our panel all day long tracking the storms for you, and I wanted to show you where the shower activity is at this moment. A little earlier, I had a Twitter conversation with proud Army wife 98, and I said right around 11:30 there was going to be a heavy cell moving through Liberty County, and right, it's scary when you have something like that happen early on in the day. It goes dark and then it starts raining again, and you're thinking, what is next? No severe weather at this time, so that's good news, just heavy rainfall. So let's track this for you as it moves toward Hinesville, and that's what we're focusing on because that's where the severe weather, the tornado threat, was earlier on in the day. So a little cell right now just on the border of Long and Liberty, but the heavier stuff still back to the west. So let's take this through Glenville, Hinesville, as it moves toward 95, and the next couple of minutes, 1116 Glenville, that's when we can see some heavy downpours for you. Hinesville around 11:48. Fort Stewart even a little bit after that. Midway, midnight, and Richmond Hill 12:18. So this will continue to fall, and there's more back to the west. There's a heavy cell now moving to Vidalia, and that will continue to track toward Claxton, Baxley, Glenville, Cobbtown. Let's do that again. Let's take this cone here again and take this across I-16, and that box will pop up. So A-Line, Metter, Portal, Statesboro, that's when that will impact you. And I wanted to show you the echo tops. We're talking about big storms developing and anything in the yellow stage, 30,000 to 45,000. We saw some of those earlier. Nothing impressive along this line back to the west. Maybe that little cell in Vidalia, but still, we are under no watches or warnings. Chief Meteorologist John Wetherbee is here to track the rest of it through the evening and what can we expect for tomorrow.
And give you a little comparison, echo tops for isolated summer thunderstorms, sometimes 65 to 70,000 feet high. These are not very tall at all. And this all continues to stretch all the way back into the Gulf of Mexico. This moisture source is continuing to train across the Florida Peninsula and into southeast Georgia. In fact, as we get a little closer to our area, again, some of those heavier cells that Jamie was talking about just a moment ago, where they're tracking, they're continuing to push rain in our direction. We've got a night of rain coming up. Let me show you the planner and I'll show you exactly what I mean. First, rainfall chances, 60, 70, 100% chances as we go through the overnight hours. From our 68 only to 64 to 60, and temperatures will fall as we go through the day, through the 50s. I don't expect anything severe from this point. I don't think we've got that to worry about. Except we're going to see some locally heavy rainfall. Dawn, that's a big part of our First Alert forecast, and that's straight ahead.
Well, a lot of our reports tonight are coming in from Fort Stewart. We're taking a live look now at a map where Stephen Gallo and Tesia Reed are in one of the hardest hit areas there, right at Green Street and Johnston Place. We're going to start our coverage with Tesia. She was at the news conference that was held shortly before 9 o'clock there. What's the very latest, Tesia?
Well, first, let's just start with the fact that there have been no injuries reported from this storm. Now, I am told there were about 40 to 50 people who were displaced. Now, they are being put up in a hotel alongside their pets just to make sure they have some shelter for the night. Now, authorities here believe that a tornado came through around 4:45 this evening. And they say it traveled about 2 to 3 miles from west to east. Now, we're looking at some video sent in to us earlier from Zach LaBar. Now, take a listen as the garrison commander talks to us about how the storm tracked through the area.
It went through Motor Pool area, across the golf course, through the housing area, clipped a little edge of the school, and then as it exited post, went through another small area of a housing area, and then across Sunbury Road and took out some power lines and trees and fences and did some damage to cars and homes as it went through the area.
Now, I did want to actually point out that they have activated an emergency family assistance center that is at the Army Community Service Building 87. Now, right now, authorities are just trying to make sure that the roadways are cleared, especially for emergency vehicles, just in case anything else happens. Now, like I said, there are no injuries reported, but there are some severe damage to some homes and some cars and some buildings. I'm going to toss it now over to Stephen, who is next to some of that damage. Stephen.
Tasia, thanks. You can see some of that damage just behind me here. If you take a look, here's one of these trees that have been uprooted here. You can just get a feel for how big it is as I'm standing next to it. In addition to that, roofs have been damaged. We've even seen several power lines across the post that are down and that have been damaged. Right now, a good portion of the base is still without power, mostly because of those down power lines. They're working on restoring it now, but the hardest hit areas may take until morning to get the power back. The National Weather Service will be here in the morning to assess damage and to confirm just how strong this tornado was. They'll be the ones to make it official, but we do know this left a good deal of damage in its path.
It was enough to splinter some trees, and like I said, the houses behind me, which are permanent structures, had the roofs torn off, so significant enough damage. And if you're back here at First Light, you'll see we've got a couple vehicles that are completely flipped over, so enough power to pick a car up and put it on its top.
Well, tomorrow, Diamond Elementary, we have learned, which is right across the street from where we are here, that school will be closed. However, the three other schools that are here on the post will be open. Again, only Diamond Elementary closed tomorrow. And as far as soldiers coming to work here in the morning, it will still be business as usual for them. It's going to be up to their unit commanders to decide if there will be any delays or changes in their schedule for their unit. By the way, the garrison commander anticipates total cleanup out here, likely to take at least 2 to 3 days till they're back to where they used to be. Live on Fort Stewart, Stephen Gallo, WTOC News.
So clearly a lot still going on the post there. We want to give you a quick rundown now again of what we do know. No injuries have been reported at Fort Stewart, just damage to homes, cars, and other buildings, as well as, of course, down power lines and trees. Crews are continuing to restore that power to parts of the post, and unit commanders will decide on delays for tomorrow. There is also a hotline to assist soldiers, families, and civilians with the latest information off the post. And that number is right there on your screen. It is 866-586-3116.
Well, we want to take a live look now at all of the photographs you've been sending us into the newsroom and on our social media pages. Again, we want to remind you, please be careful out there. Be safe when you're taking photos. You can find all of the severe weather coverage on WTOC.com. And
stay right there because John Wetherbee and Jamie Ertle will be joining us again in just a few minutes with your forecast.
And coming up, a vigil held tonight in Macon to remember a former Benedictine standout and Mercer University basketball player. Our Elizabeth Rollins caught up with Jabri Bryan's former coach today and brings us the story next.
Tonight, friends and loved ones are remembering 23-year-old Jabri Bryan, the Savannah native and former Benedictine standout athlete, was killed in Macon yesterday afternoon. Police tell us he was sitting in his car parked at a gas station when he was fatally shot. Another man sitting in the passenger seat was also injured. The shooter is still at large, but the accomplice has been arrested and charged with murder. Bryan's death is sending shockwaves, of course, through the local sports community and making national headlines as well.
Certainly is. Today, our Elizabeth Rollins spoke to many people who knew him well, including his former coach, who describes him as a smart guy and a great basketball player.
In my heart, we've been cheated.
Doug Willett coached Jabri Bryan when he was a student at Benedictine Military Academy.
He worked hard in the classroom. He worked hard in the weight room. He worked hard on his game.
And everyone in the Savannah area was well aware of Jabri's accomplishments. In fact, WTOC followed him through his high school career and even after when he moved to Macon to play for the Mercer Bears. He came back in 2014 to share his story and be an inspiration to other students with this message.
Pretty much just to stay focused. I mean, no matter what, just stay focused and continue to continue to know that hard work pays off.
The future seemed bright for the 23-year-old basketball player who is already working on his master's at Mercer. But it all ended so suddenly when he was gunned down in front of a Flash Foods in Macon.
I'm at a loss of words. How could something like that happen to a nice individual? You know, what's the world coming to?
Some neighbors had no idea about the murder until we broke the news. Jabri's mother still lives in Savannah, next door to the Rudolph family who watched him grow up. And as the word gets out, many folks are already offering their condolences to the Bryan family, including a sticky note that was left on their front door.
That shouldn't happen to any family. And I feel very upset for them. They're a nice family.
Well, Bryan was nominated for the 2016 Good Works team. He earned a bachelor's degree in accounting and was in graduate school working toward getting his MBA. Benedictine held a moment of silence today in his honor.
New at 11, a stolen TV leads police on a chase that actually ends when the suspect slams into a historic square. Metro Police tried to stop the driver on President Street after a report that he had stolen a television from the Walmart on Whitmarsh Island. The driver took off, eventually crashing into Green Square at President and Houston Streets. The suspect then ran away from the scene but left his car behind. In turn, Metro Police do expect to have an arrest warrant for the car's owner tomorrow. That crash, by the way, it took out a section of brick wall, a planter, and a light post.
Right now, county leaders in Montgomery County are struggling about what to do with county employees under indictment. Commissioners met in executive session for an hour this afternoon and elected to take no action against the county manager, Brandon Brady. Now, he's one of six people accused of entering Sheriff Ladson O'Connor's office and removing a safe and several files. The sheriff's deputy and secretary face similar burglary charges. A judge signed the arrest warrants today after a grand jury indicted them Monday. Well, don't forget, you can keep up with today's news that did not make a newscast because we were a little bit concerned about this weather today.
Yeah,
we're very concerned. Just go to our WTOC website and you can find all the information there. Right now, though, we do want to check back in with our weather team.
And right now, I wanted to show you some of the storm reports. And while they don't look impressive as far as the dots that you see on your screen, one can make a giant impression, and that's the one in Hinesville, the confirmed tornado touching down in the Fort Stewart complex. These two, look at the difference here. This is a tornado. This is a funnel cloud reported in Bloomingdale. We were first to alert you on that on air at 5, and this one at 6 on 17 and Highway 80. That was a funnel cloud that came oh so close to touching the surface, turning into a tornado, and that is a wind gust about 40 miles per hour in Beaufort recorded there. Now, I wanted to show you we're tracking those storms that will continue to move across I-16, and this is the heavier one. So Statesboro, you're going to see some heavy rain, and we're also tracking more rain back to the west. And right now, we'll put a cone in place for you. We'll track that for you right now on our satellite and radar. And we are concerned, especially everyone in the Fort Stewart complex, just because of that severe weather that rolled through. Will we see any more tonight? So right here, some of the heaviest stuff moving out of Baxley. I want to track that for you and make sure Hinesville is in this cone, because you will see some of that rain. Zion Glenville right around midnight. 122 Claxton will be impacted by this. Rain now in Hinesville, but some heavy stuff still coming around 12:35, and Midway right around 1 o'clock. Will it continue after that? Chief Meteorologist John Wetherbee has your tracking for you there.
Boy, it's really scary when storms come through and you've lost power for the day. I know how that works, and everybody's going to be okay, but there's still lots of rain here in our first alert hour by hour as we go the next several hours from our current time. Watch how this doesn't move very much. The front itself starts to lose some of its energy, but we still have lots of rain. 3:30 in the morning, and by the time we get to tomorrow morning, here comes another wave off the Gulf back to the west that will continue to fill in as we go through the day. By the time we get to noon, look at some of the heavier rain just passing Chatham County working offshore. So here's the hour-by-hour planner from 8 o'clock all the way till 4, 5, 57, 53, 52, down to 50 degrees. Temperature will fall as we go through the day, and the heavier amounts of rain should be earlier in the day with lesser amounts perhaps later in the day, but it's going to be dreary for most of the day. So our first alert level will be a 6 for tomorrow with periods of rain, possible flooding. Heaviest rain should be right along coastal areas, but after we're done with the rain from tomorrow 6, we go to a 1 on Friday and a 3 on Saturday. No worries at all. And here's how that rain will continue to push offshore. Looks like it's going to clear out of here Friday morning. We got got nothing but sunshine. Looking forward to that. So for the next 3 days, we'll check how this works out. Indeed, with our forecast, 54 tonight, rain continuing, 59 tomorrow, and periods of rain, breezy then on Friday and all sunshine, but it gets cooler. Look at that. A cooler start indeed for Saturday, 54 degrees with a 20% chance of showers. And then for the rest of the 7 day forecast, temperatures will be a little below normal. Yes, it will be cool, but nothing very exciting. Thank God.
Exactly.
You could use a boring day after today.
A couple of boring days would be just fine. Hope you're all right. Stay up to date with us always on WTOC.com and on your smartphone as well.
Thanks, John.
My pleasure.
Well, coming up, an art expo showing off the works of some local students. We'll show you their masterpieces and how you can see them for yourself.
Also, reports of the death of a longtime tradition at Georgia Southern University have been greatly exaggerated. We'll explain after this. This really is some beautiful artwork, folks. Check it out. Students from several Savannah Chatham public schools have their work on display in the 15th annual New Beginning Youth Art Exhibition. The exhibit will be on display until February 26th at the Cultural Arts Gallery on West Henry Street. This year's theme, Reflections of a Proud Legacy, and they are beautiful reflections of what these kids are capable of.
Well, tonight we're learning a Georgia Southern University tradition will live on. For more than 30 years, hundreds of children enjoyed the Spring Arts Fest. Well, Southern said last month they couldn't continue the event by themselves because of the size and the cost. Well, the Statesboro Bullock County Parks and Recreation Department announced they'll take over the event in partnership with the university. Leaders say Arts Fest just meant too much to too many people to let it end.
Well, I think anybody that's lived in Bullock County and surrounding areas over the last 20, 30 years has probably at some time involved themselves in Arts Fest.
So don't forget, look for Arts Fest April 23rd in its usual location at the university's Sweetheart Circle.
It is truly a holiday in the sports department.
The three of us were running around all over creation today, which means that fax machines all over the U.S. are going crazy. For National Signing Day, the whirlwind tour of our local talent that puts pen to paper to take their game to the next level. That's next to sports.
The WTOC Sports Desk is sponsored by Seasons of Japan.
Happy signing day. As a college fan, you really don't know how each player will turn out. As a player, you do know it's your chance at the next level to continue playing football past high school. We turn to our Rick Snow for one of the most highly recruited players in our area.
Mark Eatonberg led the Warriors to a 7-4 record this past season, rushing for 1,220 yards and 16 touchdowns. He's also a true student athlete, which pleased the coaches at Wake Forest, where Bird will be playing next season, and tells us why he chose the Demon Deacons.
I just went with my heart, and I went with Wake Forest with my heart. You know, there's a lot of schools were after me, but I just felt like Wake Forest had the best interest in me. I'm just relieved and happy that it's all over with, and I'm ready to go to college and complete my dream.
Bird was recruited by a lot of schools and had 23 total offers, but wound up choosing the ACC school.
A lot of schools, bigger schools, were looking at me and whatnot, but I just felt like Wake Forest was a perfect fit for me. You know, like small school and then comfortable, and I was comfortable with the coaches and everybody there. I felt like it was the best choice for me.
Bird's recruiting started slowly this season, but that just inspired him to do more.
It was hard, you know, being a player I am, and I wasn't getting the offers just yet, so I just had to work harder and just keep grinding, and it all pays off.
Bird plans to major in physical therapy. Rick Snow, WTOC Sports.
And it continues a Calvary day. Alex Herndon makes the huge commitment to play for Jeff Munkin as the Cavalier accepts an appointment to the United States Military Academy.
I just really felt like it was a great institution. I felt it was a great place that I could be challenged academically and physically. And I really feel like that I could be a better person by going there.
Herndon will play on the offensive line for the Black Knights. At Liberty County for Panthers, Inc., this is Calvin Holmes and Jakari Roberts, who are headed to Fort Valley State to play defense, while Jaquez Williams is headed to Wake Forest. He's going to join Bird as an outside linebacker, and Marshall Washington up the road to Georgia Southern as an outside linebacker.
We all push each other, you know, along with Richard, you know, everybody. We just worked hard, you know, here at Liberty County. We got that mentality, you know, you just got to have that dog in you, you know. All of us growing up together, playing from rec to here where we are now, like we all say, it's just a blessing, a dream come true.
And the Panthers went just 8-4 this season, losing in the second round of the playoffs. At Benedictine, True Self Cooper keeping us on our toes. He's waiting, but Sanders Creech knows where he wants to go. The cadet is packing for Charleston as he puts the pen to paper for the Citadel. Creech is a first-team All-State offensive lineman. It's a huge day in Statesboro. Five of the Blue Devils signed. Ryan Miller off to Utah State for football as a kicker. Alex Wagner to Emory for soccer. Braxton Johns, a right-handed pitcher, to East Georgia College. And Jalen Davis to Rochester for football, while Samad Foster says yes to Reinhardt. At Bluffton today, four Bobcats sign in football. Logan Veniquet is headed to Baldwin Wallace for football, while Lorenz Taylor is off to Johnson C. Smith. Dylan Wilson going to Carson Newman, while Lauren Bell headed to South Carolina Buford for track and soccer. Army also going into the low country here and gets John Beatty of Hilton Head, the Seahawks defensive back. Hilton Head's Justin Morrow is headed to Marshall as a cornerback and wide receiver combo, while quarterback Aiden Haggerty taking the preferred walk-on route going to Boston College. Just up the road at Southeast Bullock, L.A. Anderson signing for soccer there. The Yellow Jacket is bound for Bristol, Tennessee to join King University. And at Savannah Christian, Aaron Osborne signs a national letter of intent in soccer. The Raider is headed to the University of Memphis. We said a very whirlwind tour there. Don't forget, you can head over to WTOC.com, clicking on the sports page. We'll have all of your content there, including a full college wrap of each of our area schools. That's Look at Sports. We'll be back.
Now, again, we want to remind you, because of today's severe weather, Diamond Elementary School at Fort Stewart will be closed tomorrow. As of now, the other three schools on the post will remain open, and all other schools are open in our viewing area.
They
We've got a lot of phone calls.
Yeah, and again, no injuries have been reported at Fort Stewart. Crews are continuing to restore power there in parts of that installation. The unit commanders will also decide on delays for tomorrow. An important number for you once again: this is the hotline to assist soldiers, families, and civilians. It's right there on your screen. That number, 866-586-3116.
Well, John, we're looking forward to a calm day after.
But
today,
those people making those power repairs in Hinesville, they're in the rain again.
Yeah, they are.
Look at the stream of showers all the way back to the Gulf of Mexico. The front itself has really slowed down again and will stall right offshore. And we'll see these showers as we go through the night. Don't expect anything severe, but also don't be surprised if you hear a rumble of thunder, especially westbound on 16. Some of our inland counties will see some of the heaviest rain during the overnight hours. That 59 is the 7 a.m. temperature. Cools through the day. Expect light to moderate, even some heavy rainfall during the day.
All right, thanks,
John,
so much.
Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. And of course, your safety has been our primary concern all day today through these storms, and will always be. We appreciate you joining us.
Good night.